Hey everyone, welcome to our August roundtable, and this month is all about the shoulder. But before we get into the shoulder, thank you everyone, especially our Insider Access followers who are providing us with comments and feedbacks regarding all of our new videos that we're putting up. I'm pretty sure you guys were putting up at least three new videos a month, and the feedback that we're getting on those videos is that this is the information people want to see. So thank you to everyone who's subscribing, and if you have any questions, always just send us an email. So this month, August 2018, is all about the shoulder. I don't know about you guys, but I see a ton. Shoulder is probably second to low back is what I see most in the clinic. So would you guys agree with that?
Yeah, I'd say it's definitely in my top three or four. You know, I'm primarily in a spine clinic, so I see a lot of neck and low back, but shoulder is definitely up there.
And you probably see a ton of correlation. I bet your neck patients all have shoulder issues. And
oh, and back and forth. Like, I have a lot of shoulder patients with neck issues. And, you know, you get that question of like, hey, why are you treating that when, you know, my pain's down here? And so, you know, go through your typical education and explanation of what's going on.
For sure. I know one of the biggest things that I'm always working on is that person who comes in and they definitely have either some advanced tendinopathy or a partial tear. And how do you educate them that yes, you probably have some degenerative changes, but you don't need surgery? Like, that piece of education is so crucial for people who are kind of on the fence. And I think our ability to either positively or negatively impact them changes what their outcome is.
I think a lot of that stuff is our general verbiage and how we're explaining things to them. Mm-hmm. We can show them that they actually have either good strength or good range of motion or a combination of those things, and that their MRI or their specific diagnosis isn't really playing a role long term, then a lot of times they get more buy-in. They have to see it though, because they're like, oh, I have this rotator cuff problem. But then I show them, hey, listen, we just went through 10 or 15 tests and you don't have pain with any of these, or you have great range of motion in a lot of these. So that's usually what I'm seeing. And you know, I'm not sure what you guys are seeing, but I think that's just a huge buy-in if you can show them.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think if you can get some changes, hopefully in that first session too, you know, not everyone does respond that way, but if you can, then that immediately can open a window to an opportunity for you to explain and say, hey, like, we just made a change with this little trial of whether it was an exercise, some education, a manual treatment. Like, imagine what we could do with a little more regular home exercise and further application of different, you know, physical therapy techniques, whether it be manual or cognitive training.
I completely agree. It's like, how can you, and it's gotta be the right person too. The patient really needs to believe that movement and gradual return to exercise is what they want to do. But one thing that I will do at the end of my shoulder evaluations, I'll say, hey, the good news is that you're strong in all of these ranges of motion. And that strength typically shows that you're going to be successful with PT. And if they bring up the question about a rotator cuff tear or a labral issue, then I'll say, you know, there's a chance that you could have it, but let's not even worry about that right now because you're showing all of these positive signs, like Brian was saying.
Yeah, I think, you know, a lot of times I'll tell them, you know, worst case scenario, you get super strong before surgery. You have absolutely nothing to lose by doing this ahead of time. And then you come out of it so much the better, you know. Or, you know, I'll show them a scapular assist test. I like using that because a lot of times that will actually start to improve their motion or something along those lines. So, you know, there's so many times that we can show them that they don't need surgery or that PT, at least at the first step, is the right step.
Mm-hmm. And that like feeds actually right into, I know we usually talk in these roundtables about what we're going to talk about this month. And mine is the top three things that I generally give people on day one or what they come in for their evaluation. These are the top three exercises I generally give. And one of mine is, it's almost like the scapular assist version that they can do at home. And it's like a ball slide where they're just working on a range of motion, gradually improving their tolerance towards range of motion. And the purpose of it is it's to take them where their current range is and decrease the threshold of pain that they're experiencing through just repeated exercise. So you'll see that from me this month. Included in that is some front-sided opening and then scapular strengthening too, but I'm going to get into the rationale of why I'm doing each one of those things. Brian, what are you going to be talking about?
I'm going to be going through more of the overhead athlete, actually, and I'm not going to be just talking about baseball and tennis. I'm actually going to be including a lot of basketball in there. And that's something I don't see touched upon too much. I see when they talk about overhead athlete, I see a lot of tennis and baseball, but I don't see too much basketball. And I'm going to show you guys a lot of my favorite exercises for actually getting that stability at those end range positions and improving that overhead athlete position.
I think I'm actually really looking forward to reading that one. I'm giving a lecture this week on workplace injuries and treatment. And it's a very physical job with a gas company. And a lot of injuries are in the shoulder, of course, with these employees. And one of the things that I'm going to talk about is the issue with the overhead activity. And, you know, I think even you're going to be talking primarily about basketball, throwing, tennis. And I think there's probably going to be a lot of carryover to your workplace type athletes as well, just because they need that stability, especially if they're regularly having to reach overhead or push some kind of heavy load in that position as well. So I'm looking forward to it.
Mm-hmm. Chris, what are you going to be talking about in August?
It's actually going to complement Brian's post pretty well. I'm going to be primarily talking about some of the mechanics of the AC joint and then some different treatment techniques, both exercise-based and manual-based, for trying to improve the function and mobility at its end range point.
Very nice. I know the biggest question that people come in with me with AC injuries is they're on that borderline of a grade 2 to a grade 4 AC sprain of the 6 grades on the mm-hmm. scale. And they say, can I get better with conservative management? And right now the research shows that conservative management for those mid-level sprains is equal to surgical management mm-hmm. so equal to or better. So I would look forward to that.
Yeah, I think I'm going to be going a little bit different route as far as talking more about like addressing the mobility issue of it, not necessarily an injury directly to it. Because mm-hmm. The reason I wanted to address it is because for so long I looked at it as, one, we can't really assess the motion, and I still agree, like, our ability to be very specific with assessing that mobility is pretty limited. But also, I thought it'd be better to be ignorant of it almost. And I found that, especially with your people that are having a hard time with that end range motion, that it can make a huge difference in trying to get that mobility and addressing some of that pain at end range as well.
Awesome. Well, do you guys have any final parting thoughts or anything for the shoulder?
Nothing specific for the shoulder, but I hope the MPTE went well for everyone this week. And hopefully you can continue to follow us for some further pointers as you transition into the working world. Start paying off that student debt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anything on the shoulder?
Yeah, just ask as many questions as you guys can. You know, the shoulder's pretty complex, but it's a fun area to treat if you can kind of get a good handle on it. And it can take some time, but, you know, ask some questions, throw out some comments to us. You know, we love answering this stuff. We do it on a daily basis with a lot of our readers and viewers. So ask questions. We're happy to answer that stuff. It helps us think a little bit more too.
Always. I'd say my final piece is right away, when I used to see shoulders right out of school, I would focus on the strengthening aspect right away. And my advice to new clinicians is to work more initially on the first few sessions of just calming down their symptoms. So don't focus as much on trying to strengthen these smaller muscles, just get movement in the shoulder. And then once they're having less pain, then start introducing different strengthening of the specific components.
I think using like a thoracic manipulation for those clients, whether, you know, if they're the appropriate clientele, that can play a big role in at least kind of lowering that threshold, as you put it.
Absolutely. All right. Well, thank you everyone for continuing to follow us this month. We're also going to be bringing out a small code or discount code that you can use on the Insider Access. This is the first time we're doing this. Some of the feedback we've been getting is that people want a few day trial, or they want to try it just to see if it's good for them. And so we're listening to what everyone is saying. And so we're going to be implementing that in the next few weeks. So look forward to that. All right. Well, thank you for following us. We will see you in September.